Liverworts and mosses comprise a group of primitive land plants, the bryophytes. Most bryophytes are found in humid places, often beside streams and rivers. To complete their life cycles, they require abundant moisture. Though bryophytes are green and require sunlight, direct light dries them. Hence, they may grow on shaded tree trunks or the dark forest floor. As we've said, bryophytes can be classified into two groups. One group is the true mosses, bryophytes with stems and leaves. Unlike the leafy true mosses are the liverworts. The bodies of many liverworts do not have stems or leaves. Of the many kinds of liverworts, one of the most familiar is Marcantia. Marcantia may grow on damp soil or rock. The plant body, a thallus, is small, flat, and green. On its underside are hair-like projections, rhizoids. Rhizoids perform root-like functions. They anchor and absorb. But unlike true roots, each rhizoid is a long single cell of microscopic size. Rhizoids grow from the lower surface of the thallus. The upper surface of the thallus is covered with white dots. A closer look reveals that these are pores, which air may enter. Each pore supplies a many-sided chamber in which carbon dioxide is absorbed during photosynthesis. Liverworts reproduce by sexual, then asexual means. The sexual stage, a multicellular gametophyte, has gametes, or sex cells. The asexual stage, a multicellular sporophyte, has spores. Alternation between sexual and asexual reproduction, between gametophyte and sporophyte, is alternation of generations. Let's look first at the sexual generation. A particular thallus, being either male or female, grows sex structures. Male sex structures are rounded. Female ones have scalloped edges. Time-lapse photography shows how a female structure develops. At maturity, there are finger-like projections. Mature male structures are flat and disc-like. Male structures with their stalks are male branches. A liverwort with these may grow some distance from one with female branches. Adaptations make sexual reproduction between separate plants possible. To examine some adaptations, we'll detach a female branch from the thallus. We'll take a much closer look at its underside. Colorless membranes, called involucres, protect archegonia, female sex organs. Moving closer, we see three flask-shaped archegonia with long necks and rounded bases. Each base contains a microscopic egg cell, protected by structures of the female branch. The male branch is somewhat different. A cross-section reveals no involucres, but many small pits on the top surface contain antheridia, male sex organs. Antheridia are the large dark masses. A single antheridium contains thousands of fertile male sex cells. Inside them are formed very active sperms, one sperm developing in each fertile cell. The following microphotography illustrates the increasing activity of maturing sperms. Each sperm has a large rounded head and two flagella. At maturity, a sperm opens a small pore in the cell wall. Through this, it bursts from the cell. Now we more clearly see the flagella, whip-like appendages that make it possible for the sperms to move about. At the end of each flagellum is a ball-like structure, smaller than the head. Flagella may propel a sperm until it encounters an egg cell. A sperm is 10 microns long. Swimming toward a female plant a foot away, it travels the equivalent of a man walking about 40 miles. To move, liverwort sperms require moisture. For many plant species, the rainy season marks a period of intense growth. Raindrops falling on taller plants drip to the shaded ground where Marcantia lives. In this season, many liverworts complete the sexual or gametophyte parts of their reproductive cycles. Rainwater may collect atop a male branch, soaking into the pits that contain antheridia. It is in the presence of water that sperms become active. The many sperms, hundreds of thousands of them, give the water a cloudy appearance. The cloudiness spreads as sperms continue to be released. A single drop of water on the top of a single male branch may contain many hundreds of thousands of sperms. Newly released sperms move without specific orientation in different directions. In time, droplets full of sperms either fall or are splashed from the male branches. Then, entire groups of sperms move in the same direction with a sort of swimming action. This action, plus the movement of water along the ground, may carry sperms for several inches or several feet until they encounter female plants. Surface tension of the water may form a bridge to the involucres and archegonia. An archegonium is entered by sperms. Of thousands of sperms, only a few reach mature archegonia. This is in spite of the fact that ripe archegonia secrete chemicals that attract sperms. This attraction is chemotaxis. To observe chemotaxis in the laboratory, we dissect an archegonium from a female branch. From a male branch, we remove water containing sperms. We place it on the archegonium and examine it through a high-powered microscope. Following sperms, we see a general movement toward the archegonium. Experiments with similar sperms have shown that they are attracted by chemicals secreted by an archegonium. This, then, is chemotaxis. In time, sperms enter the tip of the archegonium. They travel through the long neck until eventually they reach the egg cell. Of the many sperms that may enter, only one penetrates the egg cell, fertilizing it. A fertilized egg cell, seen here in time-lapse photography, may move about for several hours. Finally, about 50 hours after fertilization, the egg begins to develop into an embryo. The embryonic stage ends the sexual or gametophyte generation in the liverwort life cycle and begins the alternate asexual or sporophyte generation. On the female branch, under each finger-like projection, there develop sporophytes, small when compared to the gametophyte body of Marcantia. Inside these are spore-producing cells. At first, these cells are in chain-like order. Then meiosis, the process of reduction division, occurs. When meiosis is complete, each spore-producing cell has given rise to four spores. As spores mature, the female branch opens. In time, it exposes the sporophytes. In each sporophyte capsule, further development takes place. Walls of the spores thicken and harden, and twisted-looking spring-like bodies form among them. These are elaters, structures capable of releasing spores from the capsule. Maturing sporophytes undergo changes, seen here in time-lapse photography. A capsule emerges from the involucres as its stalk grows. At the same time, the capsule's color changes from green to a deepening shade of yellow. Finally, 2 months after the egg was fertilized, the tip of the capsule opens irregularly, and expansion and contraction of the elaters disperses the spores. Wind may distribute liverwort spores over several square miles. Each spore, with its thick protective wall, is a complete asexual reproductive unit, which can grow into a new liverwort. Landing in a moist, adequately light environment, spores germinate immediately. Among the first signs of germination are the swelling of spores and the appearance of a number of chloroplasts. A slender filament, a protonema, grows from each germinating spore. As protonemata grow, the plants approach the state of development we saw when we began this study of alternation of generations in the liverwort. This is how a new gametophyte begins. At the end of each filament, a globular cell is formed. The cell divides, and as it does so, the resulting mass of cells begins to look more like a phallus. After some time, rhizoids grow on the young gametophyte. The phallus develops, gradually assuming the flat shape of the mature gametophyte. This cycle, gametophyte, sporophyte, and gametophyte again, illustrates alternation of generations in liverworts. Interestingly, Marcantia reproduces in other ways. A phallus reproduces vegetatively, in some instances by budding. The buds, or jemmy, grow in structures known as jemmy cups. Jemmy cups grow on female plants as well as on males. A very close look at a cup reveals the growing jemmy in it. Each looks somewhat like a small phallus. As with liverwort sperm cells, splashing rainwater activates jemmy and distributes them across the land. Water floats or splashes the jemmy from their cups. Jemmy from a female plant will grow into females, those from a male into males. Jemmy may be widely dispersed by water. Deposited in a suitable place, each of the jemmy develops into a new thallus. Though this thallus and others like it may reproduce vegetatively, we know they also reproduce sexually and asexually as alternation of generations occurs. Reviewing alternation of generations in Marcantia, we have found that the plant reproduces sexually by means of male and female sex cells, or gametes, and asexually by spores. Alternation of generations between multicellular gametophyte and sporophyte comprises the life histories of many groups of plants, including liverworts and mosses, the bryophytes.